goes too far, and he ends up kissing me. Don't know how or what I was thinking, but this ends up turning into a 20-minute drunken makeout session. We're both dudes, and neither of us are gay. Hey, what's up, everybody? I'm SkyDieRay, and welcome to another DnDGreentext video. See, now this is a great example, because it seems very different, but it sounds almost the same. And I don't really have much to add. I know you're gonna enjoy the video, so maybe leave a like now so you don't forget later. And yeah, enjoy the video. The worst type of player? I roll to persuade the guard. What do you say to him? I don't know, but I rolled a natural 20. That's good enough, right? I rolled a natural 20, alright? I don't have to give you anything else to work with here. Anon doesn't like to have fun. Tell my group that I do not find combat even the slightest bit of fun if there is no risk of character death involved. The entire group of over 12 people almost entirely disagree. Whenever I play as a player, I have zero fun because every fight is a 45 minutes minimum circle jerk where we are at no risk of losing the fight. Whenever I GM, my players roll their eyes and tune out whenever they're in danger because it's just Anon being autistic and thinking that the fight needs to have an uncertain outcome and that the player choices should impact the outcome of the fight. And the fight just ends up going to because one quarter of the team, out of principle, refuses to turn their brain on and another quarter literally just attacks and ends their turn in protest of my GM style. One player decided to run a level 15 circle jerk, where everyone plays as demigods using the most powerful homebrew they can find online. I play for 2 sessions and quit after a 3-hour fight with an illusion. The group talks about how f***ing awesome it is and talk about how strong their character is and the cool homebrew weapons and abilities like dual wielding greatswords and making 11 attacks in a turn. Unironically, these people are having fun wrong. Unironically, I think Anon just found a group that's not right for him. Like, I don't know, is there really a right and wrong way to play D&D if the players playing with super, you know, overpowered stuff and having fun without risking dying in combat? Are they really wrong for playing that way? Because if they enjoy playing like that, why does it matter? Why don't, you know, if you don't like that, just find another group? Oh, by the way, this guy mentions a 12 people group. I don't know if they manage to play every week without anyone cancelling, or they just play with whoever shows up, but that's still ridiculous. Like, too many people. Anon bores his players. I f***ing hate my players. Ignore every plot hook that I throw at them. Try everything to get them to interact with the world and NPCs other than through combat. Try to have elements of their backstory relevant to side quests as well as the main story. Keep throwing plot hooks at them that keep getting ignored. Anon, when are you gonna give us something to do? We're just wandering aimlessly with no objective. It's so tiresome. I don't know, I feel like this is one of those things that you can fix with session 0 where you discuss about how you're planning to run the campaign and stuff like that, you know, just clarify expectations and whatnot, and you know, like make sure everyone is on board, or at least clarify everything else. And if you do that, if you have a proper session 0, I don't think this should happen in your campaigns. OC. Nobody ever tells the other side of the story. Bimmy. Adult female red dragon, spending the day at home in my lair, since I have nothing else to do. An adventuring party decides to trespass. I confront them. I stand well above them, and it's clear that I'd clobber them in a fair fight. The party bard steps forward. Why, what a lovely dragon you are, my dear. Your scales look so beautiful in the light of our torches. What? The bard goes on, buttering me up with his flattery. I actually sort of like it. The more he talks, the more I grow to like him. Ultimately, I allow him to seduce me. Agree to some brief alone time with him in a dark corner of the lair. I'll spare you the details. Afterwards, bid a fond farewell to the bard as he and the rest of the party leave quickly. Can't shake the feeling that something is off. I inspect the lair and discover that some of my hoard is missing. I realize that the party stole from me while I was with the bard, and I rush to the entrance, but the party is long gone. There's nothing I can do now. I return to my inner quarters, hoping that's the end of it. However, a week later, my biorhythms start to feel irregular. I get a dragon pregnancy test, and it's positive. Not only did that bard play me while his cohort stole from me, he also got me pregnant. I feel a huge rush of emotions. Anger, fear, sadness, excitement, plus some too complicated to describe to lesser creatures. I tell my dragon friends that I can't attend their next Mansions and Mortals session. I'm too embarrassed to explain why. I end up torching a nearby village just to vent my feelings. Can I bear to raise a half-dragon child whose father seduced me for his own selfish ends? Can I bear to be rid of a child hatched from my own egg, even if it is legitimate? No matter what I choose, I'll probably regret it for the rest of my life. I'm caught in a horrible dilemma, and my life is potentially destroyed, all because some horny bard thought it was acceptable to seduce any creature that got in his way. God f- damn it, bards. Come on, such an asshole. Such an asshole move. Poor dragon lady man. I don't think the bard will come back, but maybe she can go and find him if she wants. How to cheat around dimension door's limitations. Bimi, gnomish bard who specializes in escape and trickery. Binatmi, dragonborn fighter with low intelligence. Orcish barbarian, also with low intelligence. And the chaotic evil animated skeleton wizard. The group arrives in a technologically advanced city which has highly regarded animated mannequins that are working as servants. The dragonborn fighter is intimidated by what he doesn't understand. He panics and obliterates mannequin servant with one swing. The city is clearly pissed off. Oh sh**, gotta get out of here. Just learn Dimension Door as a spell. Lets me teleport 500 feet in any direction, but can only take a creature a size smaller than me and objects that match my carry weight. Remember, I'm a gnome. Not many creatures smaller than me. Doesn't matter. The orcish barbarian leaps into action to fight off swarming city guard. Not so fast. Animated skeleton PC casts polymorph on her. Orcish barbarian fails saving throw and is turned into a small cat. The animated skeleton PC collapses his body into a pile of bones. Stuff the bones in my satchel, grab the cat, and teleport 500 feet east. Okay, end up in a random broom closet somewhere. No idea where the dragonborn fighter is. No idea how to put the skeleton back together. The orcish barbarian is still a cat. But at least we're not dead. I feel like the city guards might have just made you pay a fee or given you some prison time. Like, I feel it would have been a bit weird if the DM chose to kill you in that situation. But who knows, maybe this was the best possible outcome. Why my barbarian isn't allowed to play games anymore? Bimi, Arakokra barbarian. Binatmi, Kenku bard, newly joined half-elf paladin, and human rogue. I come from a relatively primitive tribe of hunters far to the south, so many things confuse and intrigue me. Only learned what dice were a few days ago. Can't speak common, but can understand it just fine. The party is traveling south through a long stretch of desert when it gets dark. Paladin pulls out a deck of cards and starts playing solitaire. I wander over, confused. Chirp, that MP3. Paladin looks up. Hmm? Wanna play? I blink. They're cards. Want me to teach you? Chirp. Paladin selects Slapjack. Wrong move. Takes Paladin a few minutes to explain the game, and the bard comes over and explains it to me in Primordial. Got it, that PNG. First card is turned. DM has us roll dex. I lose. The Paladin gets to the card first. Unfortunately for her, I was never told how hard I should slap. Unfortunately for her, Arakokra have talents. Roll max damage, and the Paladin loses 10 hit points. She grits her teeth and takes the card, bandaging her near mutilated hand. Chirp that wav. I laser focus the deck. Bard overturns the next card. Once again, I fail the dex contest. Don't roll as high this time, but the paladin is at half health. She sighs and takes back the deck. Done with my I remark in Primordial how strange the games here are. Bard asks me what they were like back in my tribe. Wrong move. I pick up the scrawny Kenku bard and shot put him into the sand. The rogue looks up from his book and sees the paladin tending to her mutilated hand and the bard head first in the ground like an ostrich. No longer allowed to play games. I guess Arakokra games are too much, huh? The time a rogue youthed themselves out of the campaign. Bimi, DM. Binatmi, half-elf bard, elf rogue, dwarf fighter, half-elf cleric, and dragonborn paladin. PCs be in a forest. Found some magical pools that are portals to other planes. One of them goes to the domain of the god of smithing and brewing. One fight with a coven of green hags who spiked all the beer to give everyone the worst hangover in the world later. They leave with some loot and the promise of assistance in building a construct from the god. The rogue decides to try another pool. The paladin follows them. From the paladin casting speak with animals and talking to a pig there, they learn that this plane is the domain of the sea god. He keeps pigs, which resurrect after slaughter, providing the gods with magical meat to eat. The rogue and the paladin try another pool. This time, the bard goes as well, with the cleric and fighter following after a minute. This plane is an apple orchard. The rogue immediately peeks and eats an apple. Roll a d100 for me. Rogue rolls a 100. Okay. Rogue player. How old is rogue? 66. Why? The rest of the party are stunned as I describe how the rogue shrinks into their clothes and a moment later they find a baby underneath the clothes. Fighter and cleric then show up to see the paladin holding the baby rogue. Cleric then realizes that this is the plane where the gods grow their apples of eternal youth. The party decides to go back to town and give baby rogue to a childless couple to raise. I know this was not mentioned anywhere, but I would like to imagine that the rogue was an orphan. And then this happens and this would be just amazing if the backstory of the rogue was originally that he was an orphan. He's gonna grow up and not be a rogue anymore probably, so that's nice, I guess. One less murder hobo. And yeah, I know, not all rogues are murder hobos, I know, okay. Just bros being bros. I f***ed up. BDM for a 5th edition group. Rather than just using inspiration, we have a house rule on charisma check, wherein if you act out the check convincingly, you can gain advantage. Leads to some pretty fun roleplaying moments. Last session, we all have a little too much to drink. We were playing a drinking game where the whole table has to take a shot whenever a player fails a roll. Have a player whose character is a female harlequin team, their cane trickster, wants to seduce a noble for information, using house rule and thinks it would be funny if he acted out seducing me, just far gone enough to play along with it. We get a bit too into it while the rest of the party is cracking up. Goes too far and he ends up kissing me. Don't know how or what I was thinking, but this ends up turning into a 20 minute drunken makeout session. We're both dudes and neither of us are gay. Feel really awkward the next morning. Haven't heard from him since. Feel too weird to make plans for the next session. Is there a way I can salvage this? We were having a lot of fun with the campaign up until this point. Okay. I'm not saying that anyone in the story is gay or bisexual, but maybe think about it. Not how I expected the story to end anyway. Alright, on that note, we're gonna end this video here. So thank you guys so much for watching. I hope you enjoyed it. Please leave a like if you did and subscribe for more if you haven't already. Also, thank you to everyone supporting the channel on Patreon. I really appreciate it. So thanks a lot for everyone supporting the channel there. Links below to all my social media or the Discord and subreddit if you wanna join, check out those. And yeah, that's it. Thanks again for watching and I'll see you next time. Have a great day. Bye.